More than 50 million girls under the age of 17 are already married in developing countries, and 100 million more are expected to marry in the next decade. Photojournalist Stephanie Sinclair has traveled to Yemen, Afghanistan, Nepal, India, and Ethiopia documenting the practice of child marriage. Over the past 8 years, she's gained intimate access to families and child brides who can be as young as 5 years old at the time of marriage. Her photographs were recently featured in National Geographic magazine in a story called Too Young to Wed. She joins me now. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
The story that of the five-year-old little girl in India that was being led off to her wedding was so powerful. You were looking at that girl while she's being carried on her shoulders, just like any other five-year-old girl would. But what was that scene like?
Yeah, that was a very, very intense situation. It was a wedding that was held at about 4 o'clock in the morning, and they held it in secret because it's technically illegal to have underage marriages in India. But it's not really enforced, but just out of protection, especially when they're very young like that, they have them in the middle of the night. And Rajini was sleeping. She had gone to sleep much earlier, and they literally woke her up and put her over the uncle's shoulder and then took her to her wedding.
What are the key drivers behind it? Is it just about geography? Is it just about country? Is it just about religion? Why is it still happening?
It's happening for a lot of reasons. I would say the primary one is still poverty. It happens, in my experience, I've seen it where there's lack of communication, lack of roads, lack of schools. So these are parts of the world where it's not very developed. But there's traditional issues that are involved. There are, religion has always been a justifier in almost every situation I've been in, regardless of whether it was Islamic or Hindu or Christian weddings. They were always, there was some sort of justification why it was allowed to happen. And that's what makes this issue such a difficult one to deal with, and one that's a bit taboo. People don't really want to get involved because they feel like, oh, well, this might ruffle feathers in a kind of more profound way. But, thankfully we have organizations like the Elders and, high-up officials such as Ambassador Revere and Secretary Clinton who are kind of interested in these issues and are kind of pushing it in trying to break some of the stigma around dealing with the issue of child marriage.
Now, every once in a while, there was a story kind of pierces through, or an individual pierces through. In your piece in National Geographic, it goes into the story of Najood Ali, a 10-year-old Yemeni girl who showed up at a courthouse by herself, but she's really the exception, not the rule.
She is the exception, and she's a very brave, very strong girl. And she was living in Sana'a, so you have girls who are in areas such as Hajja, which is where most of these underage marriages happen, and they don't have access to courthouses or lawyers, and so they don't have the same resources, and there's not even enough schools to be able to kind of even go to a teacher about what their situation is.
And let's get to that idea of education. So many of these girls that are in these systems are not educated at all. There's a paragraph that says that their nurses were, in some circumstances, describing reproductive health practices while a young girl was in active labor, just telling her what was going on.
This is absolutely true. In fact, I spoke with a gynecologist in Hajja, this area of Yemen, and she told me that most of the girls had no idea what was going on with their bodies. They knew very little about reproductive health. I spoke to an 8-year-old girl named Tahani, who is sexually active with her husband, and who's in his late 20s, early 30s, and she didn't have any idea how babies were made, about anything. She just thought that you just get pregnant and have a baby, but she had, she had been to only a few years of school and didn't have an opportunity to learn that from anybody.
So I've got to ask, as a reporter or as a photographer, how did you get access here, and how did you develop a level of trust where you could be so intimate with these characters?
Well, I've been working on this project for a long time, so I've been able to show people in the communities the work I've already done, and they can see that I hope they can see that it's been done with respect and care for the communities and care for the people, the girls in the situation, but also the people who want this practice to stop. And every time that I've been granted access, it was because there was someone within the community and within those families who were willing to grant us permission, who didn't necessarily like the practice and who wanted, but just felt like it was beyond their control. They had to participate. And so, but they wanted their voices to be heard. And I had actually one mother in Afghanistan who I photographed the engagement of a young girl, 11-year-old girl, to a man in his 50s. And the mother was crying and telling me, you know, we don't have enough food to feed the rest of our children. We're selling our girls. So, I mean, the families want attention to this issue, at least on some level, either through because of their worried with about poverty and, you know, lack of education and not having any other options, or because they, too, were married at very young ages, which was the case in Nepal. The young men in the community who were in their early 20s were married very young as well. And they wanted to grant us access.
Perpetuates, yeah. So now, well, is there a community-based solution that's working in some of these communities? I think the knee-jerk reaction, a lot of people say, well, gosh, can't we just take them out and immediately rescue them somewhere? But is there something a little bit more systemic that's working?
That's a good question. For sure, schools are the best answer. But it's not just schools just for regular education. I think educating the societies, those communities, those villages about reproductive health, about the consequences of early marriage are just as important as regular, you know, primary education. In Yemen, one of the biggest issues is there's, you know, they don't have very many schools, and the ones they do have very few women teachers. So the young girls can't go because there's no women teachers. So it's difficult, but I think education of the communities on a basic education level for the children and for the families is important.
All right, Stephanie Sinclair, the story is in National Geographic magazine in the June issue. It's called Too Young to Wed. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you so much for having me.